to Mainland Television Regional News. I'm Graham O'Brien, and coming up in today's bulletin, no fireworks for Nelson Mass Parade, policing the busy weekend, Beetson Road shortcut cut short, Motueka Bridge replacement too expensive for budget, Mighty Marcos kill Canterbury's hopes for a place in final, and Nelson Duo Broods have nominations for two awards. The 20th year celebration of the Mass Parade took place on the streets of Nelson last Friday, with primary and secondary schools and local groups and individuals all taking part. A great Nelson crowd turned out to line the streets for the event. Those that were closest to the corners of Trafalgar and Hardy Streets were treated to a display of music and dancing as a crowd warmer before the parade began. Organisers said that Nelson turned out more than 2,500 Nelsonians parading through the inner city streets, with an estimated crowd of about 15 to 20,000 watching on. They were thrilled with the high level of spectator interaction and with the huge effort many participants had put into design elaborate and colourful costumes in the Earth, Wind and Fire theme. Nelson City Councillor Luke Ackland said that the parade and More FM's carnival were a great success. Everyone was in full festive spirit despite the grey clouds threatening at times. He said Nelsonians are truly dedicated to the Mask Parade, the turnout was fantastic and the mask and performances were outstanding. Mainland crews went along to both the parade and the carnival, and our reporter Chrissy Small said that the parade was a great but noticed there was a lack of crowd control marshals with people spilling out onto the street. However, fortunately the crowd were well behaved. The standout winners, Tasman School, were a crowd favourite in their steampunk outfits, with even councillor and event MC Matt Laurie exclaiming, "Wow, Tasman, wow." Being the 20th year celebration, there may have been an expectation of something bigger that never evolved, and that with both events, the job was effectively done. But to some, it may have felt there was been a bit of a lack of vision for this milestone event. No band to lead in the parade from the first may have left it lacking a drive from the beginning, and that the way the street had been organised meant that not all the crowds were privy to some full performances. Communication about winner announcement and prize giving was also lacking, and meant that many of those taking part in the parade had left before these had been announced. The carnival seemed to have many gaps, with a lack of bouncy castles and sideshows to entertain the young mask paraders, meaning young families possibly left early, and while everything was spaced well apart, it appeared too big with no fillers. The small amount of street performers there had a large space to fill and no chance of ever doing so. However, the music from various individuals, groups and bands were great from woe to go, and although the crowds for the carnival seemed small in part, they were certainly appreciative. The Mask Parade winners this year were first prize for Best Individual, Carl Wolf; first prize for Best Group, Hickey Picks, Southern Steamers; second prize for Best Group, Dance the Sun; first prize for Best School, Tasman School; second prize for Best School, Birchwood School, Kim Mary; and Supreme Award went to Tasman School. Chrissy Small caught up with Tasman School headmistress Pip Wells and Tasman School teacher Fred Robinson after they got their award.
Tasman School, Pip Wells, you must be excited that you guys have just walked away with not one award, but two. We're absolutely ecstatic, and the kids so deserve it. Our whole community got really excited about this theme. It fits with our whole ethos of recycling, and steampunk just it just took off. It was magic. Yeah, we're really happy. Yeah.
So it must have taken quite a bit of junk to kind of put these costumes together, you guys. That must be quite a good bit of recycling you've done there, Pip.
Well, in actual fact, if you saw our hall, you wouldn't be able to see the floor. But we can fairly honestly say that we've recycled probably about a third of the recycle centre. So we've had a lot of stuff that's gone into that, all secondhand, all rubbish, all bits and pieces. Yeah.
Well, look, you're a bit of a creative genius, but Fred, come back here into the shot of the camera. We know you are actually quite a creative genius too. I would say that the mechanical looking items do spin. Yeah, come back. Now, I would say that you had a great deal of input into this machinery.
Ah, yes, there's a lot of input from parents, actually, a huge amount of input. So we've all put things together ourselves. It was a great big sort of brainstorming one day with parents and teachers. We all said, yeah, steampunk, we all just lit up. So a lot of people just got right behind it, and before we knew it, bang, it was away.
Yep. In particular, we had a couple of parents that we couldn't have done without, Jules and Stella.
and Sally and a whole bunch of other people, but those three in particular just really made it happen for us. So we couldn't have done it without them. Yeah, yeah. It's a whole community event, literally. Yeah.
Well, look, you guys have pulled it off. You've won the best school. You've won the Supreme Award.
Fantastic. It's pretty special that it's the 20 years since Kim Berry actually started this whole parade, so that makes it extra special for us.
Yeah.
But really, it's just a celebration of our community. They're pretty awesome out at Tasman.
They are. And you know, for a small school, you certainly turn it out, don't you?
We do. Yes, we like to turn it out. We've got a good staff, a good parent community, and a good bunch of kids, so we can't fail. Yeah.
Dead right.
Well, congratulations from all of us at Mainland.
Thank you. Yay. It's great. Thanks, everyone.
Party time.
The Masked Parade and Carnival are part of the Nelson Arts Festival, which is running until the 27th of October. And we will be bringing you more footage taken of the parade on Friday's news. With Nelson's huge weekend of the Masked Parade, Carnival, ITM Rugby Semi-Final, Speedway and Hell's Angels on holiday being at an end, I caught up with Steve Greeley, District Area Police Commander, to ask how the weekend went for the police, and were the extra officers that were brought into the area needed, or did the local bobbies take a chance to get a bit of a break from it all?
I think earlier on in the week I described this as the perfect storm for Nelson Bays. You know, we had the Masked Parade, which typically attracts around 20 to 25,000 people. I think in the past, when police haven't policed that event, we've had some real problems with youth hanging around with alcohol, which has created all sorts of problems. So we knew what we were up against there. We had the Hells Angels arriving for the long weekend for their national run. We had the ITM Cup semi-final. Very, very, very passionate fans here for that, of course, for the Marcos. And then we had the Speedway on as well on the same night. Yeah. So that's really, really important that we get it right in terms of how we deploy our staff. And we talk about prevention first. We deploy to beat demand. So it was important we had enough staff. So we pulled in some people from Wellington, from Auckland, from Christchurch, all that sort of thing. But and they worked with their own staff. So no, none of our guys got a break, unfortunately. But when you've got all that sort of thing happening and you've got Bridge Street, potential for violence is very, very high. Yep. So we had to get that right too. But I'm really, really happy the way it went.
So you were happy with how everything went? There were no real big problems?
There were no real problems. I think we made two very low-level arrests at the Masked Parade. These are young people with alcohol, so that was easy to deal with. Both those people were released with a pre-charge warning. We made 14 arrests on Bridge Street, but that was, again, low-level disorder. Nothing major. And so we had no assaults report on Bridge Street that night, which is amazing.
Yeah. Oh, it's fantastic.
Yeah, it was great.
And I mean, we can all just thank that all of these things go off without a hitch and there is no trouble because of the work that you do. So thank you very much.
Hey, no worries. No, it's a pleasure. But we're glad that we came in on the equation that way. So it could have gone so wrong if we didn't deploy that way. So yeah, no, but I'd also like to say thanks very much to the community, because the community members are the people who went there with the right attitudes. People on Bridge Street understand the rules and that they're coming along with it really nicely. So all in all, a very pleasing result. And I think rather than the perfect storm, it was more like a gentle breeze. So that was good. Happy with that.
Excellent. Thanks very much.
No worries.
Perceived delays caused by peak hour traffic vehicles taking a shortcut up Beetson Road will be tested with a temporary road closure trial in November. The closure will take place at the entrance to Beetson's Road from Fokatoo Drive roundabout. Residents will be advised at least a week in advance of the start of the trial closure. Council Works and Infrastructure Committee approved the trial that will run for 2 weeks, only on weekday mornings between 7:30 and 9:30 a.m. The results of the trial will be reported back to the Works and Infrastructure Committee. Committee Chair Eric Davey told Mainland News that drivers are using Beetson Road as a rat run to try and avoid queues in the morning peak, which has been a source of complaints from residents and drivers alike for many years. There is a perception that drivers trying to rejoin Waimea Road at the top of Beetson Road contribute to the traffic delays. This may be exacerbated by vehicles on Waimea Road slowing to let rat-running vehicles into the traffic flow. He said they are going to monitor the situation before the trial closure and during it to get a clearer picture of the issue and whether or not it is slowing traffic. He told us that they have based this road closure trial on a study carried out 2 years ago that showed 40% of people travelling to the city on that road were taking a shortcut. Previously, a series of speed humps and chicanes were installed on Beetson Road in an effort to make the street less attractive as a shortcut. And some further news from further out of Nelson. If you've ever felt nervous about driving over the Motueka Bridge on the way to Golden Bay or Kaitiriti, then you may be relieved to know that the New Zealand Transport Agency is considering a new option for making the river bridge safer to use by adding about a metre to its width to serve for the next 20 or 30 years. This widening, with a cost estimate of $5 million, would fit into the NZTA's 2018 to 2021 planning cycle. Serious concerns were expressed by the Motueka Area Board at its June meeting, resulting in TDC and NZTA engineers assessing the bridge state and future. Several community board members said one problem that needed more urgent action was to realign the eastern approach to make it less sharply angled so drivers could easily see when entering the bridge. The NZTA report said that although the bridge is 95 years old, there are quite a few around the country of this age which are narrower than today's standards and in similar condition. Cost of repairs in the next 10 years is expected to be very modest compared to the cost of replacement. The remaining life of the bridge is 15 to 30 years, but bridge replacement based on current condition is not justified at present. A replacement bridge would cost about $25 million, about $10 million for the bridge itself and $15 million for issues around the new road alignment. This is too expensive for the NZTA's present long-term plan budgets. A replacement would need to be a 100-year investment, and then planning would also get mixed in with town road bypass issues and new locations for alignments. This widening proposal could mean a satisfactory temporary solution for 20 to 30 years, while a new bridge could be planned. Over the past 5 years, there have been 17 minor and no injuries recorded. A rugby dynasty was toppled on Saturday. The Marcos' decisive win 26-6 at the ITM Cup semi-final at Trafalgar Park ended Canterbury's six-year reign as New Zealand Premiership champions. It also means Tasman are one win away from becoming the first team to win the championship and premiership titles in consecutive seasons as they contemplate this Saturday's final against Taranaki in New Plymouth. In keeping with Tasman's 38-10 win over the Red and Blacks in Christchurch 2 weeks ago with a superb defensive effort by the Marcos to keep Canterbury tryless. With Tasman leading throughout and scoring the game's two tries both in the first half, taking 28 minutes for Canterbury to get points on the board. Canterbury spent much of the first half on attack, but Tasman defenders hit them in waves. Saturday's win marks a proud moment for a franchise that has come close to being relegated to the second division or completely folding on several occasions in its 9-year existence. But now, it's just one win away from being named the top provincial team in the country. And finally today, after having just completed 43 days touring this month with 32 shows across the USA, ending with a sellout headline show at the El Rey in California, Nelson brother and sister duo Broods have 3 nominations in the Vodafone New Zealand Music Awards. Caleb and Georgia Knott have received nominations for Best Single of the Year for Bridges, plus a nomination for Breakthrough Artist of the Year, as well as the People's Choice Award.